Good morning. It's probably not working, but it's fine, right?
It's just to get your voice back here. It's not for
the call. Okay, fantastic. So, I'm afraid I will disappoint you because the talk which I'm prepared is not really about random matrices, but rather about some ideas which came from my work in random matrices with Anton Zabrodin, which propagates to hydrodynamics, but I can't really deviate from what I'm doing now, and this is what I'm doing now, so I can't talk about anything else. Somehow it's related to random matrices, but I will mention them in just one or two slides. So I apologize for possible disappointment. Okay, so this is a subject which kind of a new subject, new and old simultaneously, which I am currently discussing with Sasha Abanov and Eldad Betelheim, and here's what it is about. That's about two-dimensional hydrodynamics of incompressible fluid. On this slide, there is an outline of what I'm going to talk about, but it may not be useful since you don't know what I'm going to talk about. But let me still list what is written here. So I say a few words, a few slides about, general slides about hydrodynamics of incompressible flows in two spatial dimensions. Maybe a few words about search for conformal invariance. Then I introduce and discuss Kirchhoff equations in hydrodynamics and relate them to Ansegger ensemble and random matrix theory. But my major theme is anomalous forces in hydrodynamics. I will explain what it means. And maybe a few comments in the end about relation hydrodynamics and random matrices on Riemann surfaces, and also another comment about relation between random matrices and random Riemann surfaces. But it will be very little mathematics, but my goal will be to formulate the problem. Okay, first of all, let me consider classical fluid, say water. Water is a good example, but in two spatial dimensions. So water on a plane, maybe shallow water in a lake or in laboratory. So if the fluid is incompressible, I will explain what it means in a second. It means that on a closed manifold, the only motion is in this fluid is possible due to vortices. No vortices, no motion. And the reason for that is that in two dimension, velocity is a two vector, but in compressibility condition, saying that velocity is divergence-free, essentially eliminates 1 degree of freedom, only another degree of freedom. Only 1 degree of freedom remains, which is vorticity. So no vortices, no motion, if there is no boundaries. And that's a typical picture of turbulent flow, which consists of vortices. This everywhere is vortex, and the motion of fluid between these vortices is determined by position of vortices. So basically, if you give me these points, centers of vortices, I will determine two things. I will determine their velocity, and I determine the velocity of the fluid all over the places. So fixing these points and circulation of vortices will determine everything else. And this picture illustrates very interesting and profound idea in two-dimensional Euler hydrodynamics. Euler hydrodynamics simply means non-inviscid. Inviscid. I assume that liquid is inviscid. That this complex motion actually finite dimensional because it's fully determined by position of these vortices. And I will develop this idea in the talk. But now I would like to say that position of these vortices, these points on a plane, statistically equivalent to eigenvalues of random matrix ensembles. So you think about big matrix, that's a theme of this conference. There are two themes of this conference, matrices and non-equilibrium. That seems to fit. It's very non-equilibrium, as you can see. There is a movie, of course. This is part of the movie. So if I would able to switch the movie, it will be very non-equilibrium, so everything will move. But my major point, which is very old point, which going back to Ansager, perhaps I will tell about this, that every point here statistically is equivalent to random eigenvalues of random matrix. Of course, random matrix must have complex eigenvalues, so they're located on a plane. It's not about Hermitian eigenvalues, Hermitian matrices, but rather about normal matrices or general matrices where eigenvalues are located on a plane. So this by itself an interesting statement and maybe rather dramatic. We usually know that eigenvalues of random matrices are related to many, many things, you know, spectrum and nuclei, zeros of Riemann zeta function. But that's another incarnation of random matrices. So study of random matrices and the behavior of the eigenvalues pushed us, people whom I mentioned, to an idea that maybe stochastic properties or statistical properties of eigenvalues in random matrices may be eventually key to turbulence. I seriously believe that it's true, that it's far from being developed, but the story which I'm going to say is just a small step towards in that direction. Okay. My talk will be rather elementary, so I will appreciate if I will be happy if I generate questions during the talk.
So why norm?
I need eigenvalues on a plane. That's it. Any matrix.
This complex.
So general GLN matrix will be fine, too. Okay, but first of all, the major problem here in this business is how to formulate the problem. What is the problem, actually? What to study? And that's what I'm going to say. To talk about. So, looking on this picture, we recognize that there are maybe this is a major slide on the talk. So looking on this picture, we recognize that there are two kinds of motions. One is very fast motion of fluid precessing around each vortex. So it's run like crazy. And if the vortex is a point-like, which is kind of possible in incompressible inviscid fluid under some approximation, then velocity at the center is infinite. So it's really singular motion and very, very fast. That's fast motion. But then there is another motion, so-called slow motion, which is motion of centers of vortices themselves. Fluid moves very fast, even vortices do not move and form a stationary state. They stay, but fluid moves. But another possibility is that vortices move and fluid moves around them, and vortices move slowly and fluid move fast. When looking on this picture, we don't, but the termin of slow motion of vortices determines the fast motion of fluid, because it's everything is all interconnected. So the problem is, now looking on this picture, we definitely are not interested in fast motion. First of all, it can be found from the slow motion. Second, we are not interested in this. We want to average on it, over it, and discuss only slow motion. Since in turbulent flow, the number of these vortices is huge, and the distance between them is small, so they occupy the whole volume, one can think about them as a constituency of a new fluid, secondary fluid. So fluid consists of molecules of water. That's the primary fluid, which consists of two different kinds of motions. But we can consider secondary fluid, where molecules of the secondary fluid constituency are vortices themselves, and this fluid moves slowly. Of course, it's possible only in a particular limit, when this distance between them fixed fine, small, the number of vortices growing, the volume growing, but the density kept fixed. Then the question is, and this is what I'm going to discuss, what is the hydrodynamics of the vortex fluid? So vortices themselves form a matter or fluid. They actually form a lattice sometimes, but sometimes fluid. And we are asking, what is the hydrodynamics of that fluid? So let me bring an analog to explain this. It's pretty elementary thing, but elementary idea, but I would like to explain it. So to visualize it, suppose I come on the shore of a very turbulent flow. So there are vortices everywhere, and I'm looking on staying on a, say, rock, and looking down, and everything moves in front of me. So, I suppose I have a basket of rice. So I throw rice to water, and every rice grain occupy a position inside vortex. And suddenly water becomes calm, namely it's moving, but I'm looking only on rice. Rice cover all water, and this rice also moving. This form its own vortices, its own hydrodynamics, and this is hydrodynamics I am about. Right? So since I said already that there is some relation between position of these vortices and random matrices and eigenvalues of random matrices, so motion of this random matrix, eigenvalues of random matrices, give insight to that question. And that's what I am going to talk about. Okay. It so happens that hydrodynamics of vortex flow, or vortex matter, is anomalous. And I'm going to explain what is anomalous hydrodynamics in the next slide. And the only assumption I would like to make is that circulation of vortices are bounded. It's not always true. In real fluid, circulation of vortices can be any, no, not bounded. There are certain cases where circulation of vortices are bounded from below, namely circulation more than some number. And this number has dimension, and that's a new scale in the problem. I was going to fix it. It's kind of quantization. So that happened in superfluids, where vortices are quantized. This will happen, of course, in random matrices. It will be a parameter. It's happened in quantum fluids, when that will be Planck constant. And it also happened in turbulence, when we put a spoon in the water, in fluid, and move. We inject vorticity. And this is how fast we rotate the spoon. So two cases. I'm coming to it. When we talk about turbulence, circulation has either sign, positive, negative. But in a few next slide, I will say that I will concentrate only on the chiral motion when circulation will have one sign. This is simplification, but this is as far as I can go. But thank you. But it's coming.
So yes, that means that the number is conserved.
Number, yeah, I'm coming to this too. Okay. So now I would like to explain. So this is my major assumption. I will going to explain what hydrodynamics of what is anomalous hydrodynamics. Excuse me. The previous slide. So anomalous hydrodynamics. Let me remind you. Let me start from Euler equation of regular hydrodynamics. Euler equation says that if u is the velocity of the fluid, then material derivative of u is the gradient of pressure, and material derivative, it's a covariant derivative with the flow. It's a time derivative plus parallel transport. And if the fluid is incompressible, then pressure will be found through velocity. It's not an independent variable, not an independent quantity. That's the Euler equation. Now, anomalous Euler equation, different from Euler equation by possessing so-called anomalous terms. Anomalous terms written as a divergence of some stress tensor, anomalous stress tensor, which is a symmetric tensor, but it's a pseudotensor. Forces usually are stress tensor usually a tensor, but this is a pseudotensor. If it's pseudotensor, this is called anomalous stress. In two dimension, possibility for pseudotensors is very limited, and this is what one possibility, the only possibility which is available. I will write it down. So it's a symmetric tensor. It consists of off-diagonal components and diagonal components. It's traceless, and it's linear in velocity and linear in gradients. So that's by dimensions. That's the term with the minimal pseudotensor with the dimension. And eta is dimensionless number, which is a kind of a kinetic anomalous kinetic coefficient. It's convenient to write this tensor not in component but in holomorphic component. If tau is holomorphic component of the tensor, this definition, then it's simply holomorphic derivative of velocity with the I in front. Trace vanish. That's a general definition. In higher dimension, anomalous terms also exist, but they are not linear in velocity, but bilinear, trilinear, as they're growing with the dimension. So when this, there are rare examples when this happened, and apparently it will happen in this vortex fluid. So what dimension, what these forces represents? They represent forces acting to on shear. Suppose I have a shear flow. So fluid goes this way along the x direction, but velocity change in y. So it's a shear. Then there are special forces, which these anomalous forces, which acting normal to the shear, like these forces, right? So they push this line apart. They repel flow lines of the shear flow. Forces acting normal, and therefore they produce no work, and the system is conservative. Contrary to viscous forces which acting this way, this direction, which stop the fluid and they produce dissipation, those forces do not. Okay. Now, so my major thing which I would like to explain today is that the fluid vortex, the vortex fluid possess anomalous forces, and this basically a concentrated way to describe the hydrodynamics. It's a hydrodynamic of the regular fluid plus this anomalous forces. And it all follows from random matrices, but I will show it on some, not using random matrix technique, but on some elementary manner. But that's a major message. Okay. Okay, now I start the story. So a short digression for about hydrodynamics of incompressible fluids, not forces. So Euler equation, as I repeat, D is the material derivative. I assume that the fluid is incompressible, namely divergence of velocity vanish, and vorticity is the only degrees of freedom remains. So one can take a curl from this equation, of Euler equation, and write equation entirely on vorticity. That is so-called, in some books it's called Helmholtz equation. It's simply curl of this equation. Under the curl, pressure vanish, and the equation becomes extremely simple. It said that material derivative of vorticity vanish. It's actually highly non-linear equation, because it's an equation for vorticity, what U express through vorticity too. But it's not equation, actually. It's a geometrical statement. It says that vorticity is simply frozen to the flow. You don't need to write it. It's pure geometry. But if you try to solve it, you get pictures like that. It's extremely complicated. But there is nothing but geometry here. Okay. Okay. Now, so this is a major equation which only remains for inviscid two-dimensional incompressible fluid. There is only one equation, not two. So it's a Helmholtz form of Euler equation, and solution of this equation describe all this mess. Okay. So we can think about it as a pseudo-scalar moving with the flow, but arrange the flow itself. Okay, now, more than 120 years ago, in late 19th century, Helmholtz and later Kirchhoff found simple solutions of this equation. It's a finite dimensional solution, which says that the flow velocity consists of is a meromorphic function at where poles are located in vortex position. So it's called point-like solution. So vortices assumed to be points, and velocity is simply a meromorphic function with these poles. So n is number of vortices, gamma are their circulation, and Kelvin theorem will tell us that n is conserved in time. If we have five vortices, it will be five vortices for the rest of the life, and gammas are also conserved in time, and the only what is moving is position of vortices. So plugging this into the equation, we will have equation for position of vortices. And that equation is called Kirchhoff equation. It's written here. It tells that vortices is moving only under effect of the Magnus force from other vortices. Right? So so that is the integral of motion is constant. This is a constant. And it's a many-body theory, many-body problem which you have to solve to describe the entire hydrodynamics. The only problem is that this n must be large. There is a mathematical theorem which says that playing with this n and gamma, we can, in some sense, approximate any flow. It's it's pretty old theorem, maybe 15 years old, but instead of solving PD, we can solve a finite number of OD. It's a sort of remarkable fact. It's not very often happened that this complex motion on the continuum media reduces to finite number of equations. That's what happened in hydrodynamics, just in water, in our sink. Okay. And this is a very good approximation, apparently. That problem has been studied for small n. It has been proven that for n more than 3, four, starting from 4, the motion is chaotic. Okay. Now you may recognize already some structures which we have in random matrices, but that's where it's coming from. Okay. Okay. Now, now about I come to the your point. So, what known in turbulence is that if you have a box and consider turbulent flow, leave it alone, that what will happen eventually, that vortex is positive and negative, clockwise and anticlockwise, they don't like each other, they decided to congregate and or clusterize to two clusters clockwise and anticlockwise, and this cluster separates. And only box stops them. There are two regimes. One is inside, where positive and negative mix, and this is what really turbulence. And there are more coherent structures which are separated. And once you are sitting here, you may consider only one and forget about another. They well separated. And this is my case. Those structures has been predicted by Onsager in early 50s. And a great example of this is which we see every day. For those who has Apple computer and Apple screen, we see this picture every day. It's a red spot of Jupiter. It's believed, some group of people believe, there are many points of view what is this about, but some group of people believe that this is one of this cluster of huge vortexes. So it's huge vortex, but it actually consists of many, many small vortices, right? And let me now remind you that every small vortices in here is an eigenvalue of random matrix. And altogether, it's a big vortex page. So I cannot address what happened here, but I can say what happened inside here. Okay, and inside here, I will have the same Kirchhoff equation, but when these circulations are all positive, and let me assume them for simplicity, they all have the same size. So it's just a number, not many of them, but just a number. So it goes out of the bracket. And that's omega means that the whole thing rotates. But it's more convenient to put yourself in a rotating frame such as it stays in front of you. So vortex is not moving around the center, but you're also moving around the center, you just look on them. And that's moving through the system at this term. Okay, now, Kirchhoff equations are Hamiltonian, and this was found by Kirchhoff, and those equations can be produced out of the Hamiltonian, which is written here, and under simple canonical Poisson, symplectic Poisson brackets, when the Z and Z bar position of these vortices form a symplectic manifold on dimension 2n, n is the size of the vortex. So if you have this Hamiltonian, this Poisson brackets, then Kirchhoff equations coming, and therefore Euler equations. Okay. Okay. Now, in early 50s, Onsager suggested that entries of Kirchhoff equation. Entries of the Kirchhoff equations can be treated stochastically. And this is what is called thermodynamics of Onsager ensemble. So he assumes that he considers a stationary state, stationary equilibrium, not equilibrium state, like here. And assumes that these vortices form ensemble with some temperature. He considered two positive and negative, but for positive vortices of one side with this Hamiltonian, this is ensemble which you pick up. So probability to find all these vortices is e to the Hamiltonian to the energy with a certain temperature, and dimensionless parameter beta is the ratio between circulation square and the temperature in good units, and that's a very recognizable ensemble of Dyson gas. It's called the beta ensemble of Dyson gas, or beta Dyson gas ensemble. I know beta is a parameter, dimensionless parameter. This term coming from the fact that there is a solid rotation all around, and this term is Magnus forces of represent Magnus forces between vortices.
Other communities, you would say this is the gellium.
It's helium.
Gellium.
Gellium. What is gellium?
deuterium is the Coulomb gas where all the particles are
charged. Yeah. So you can think about it as a plasma, that's what you're referring to, right? And this is a charge distributed in the substrate, which neutralizes the ground. But in hydrodynamic interpretation, that will be Coriolis force, and that's a Magnus force between Coriolis, because everything rotates, and this will be Magnus force between vortices. As I said, that and that's what we studied extensively, but that's thermodynamics, and I would like to talk about kinetics. But inside the thermodynamics, we know very well the statistics of the ZIs, and let me remind you that every ZI is a vortex in hydrodynamics, and they form a so-called Ginibre ensemble with a well-known distribution, and this is a picture which belongs to Kang. And there is about 2,000 points here, and that's the most probable positions of Z's in this thing. So you can think about it as a red spot of Jupiter, and every point here represents a vortex.
Ginibre is beta equal 1,
right? Yeah, Ginibre is usually beta equal 1, I'm sorry. But in here, parameter beta plays a central role, hugely essential role. It's a parameter. It's a parameter of quantization, if you wish, or temperature in Ansager language, or a noise, which you of Langevin forces, which you add to the system to make them stochastic. Yeah, and this beta plays a major role, and what I'm going to do later, in the rest of is my last 20 minutes. Is I assume beta is very large, such that the things will be simply classical. Not that I like it, I can do it quantumly, namely beta arbitrary, but for the sake of simplifying formulas, it's better to think about it as a very large and see what happens. Okay. So it's a large temperature. Sorry, small temperature. Almost classical, but it's not really important, but okay, so now let's talk about hydrodynamics of this system. So what do you want to do? I have a many-body theory, many-body system, so it's just a collection of ODEs, but many. And I would like to go to naive mathematical limit, which I cannot justify at all, but some people can, to specify initial data for the system such that it makes sense to talk about density. Density, I write naive formula, and I assume that if n is large and conditions are proper, initial conditions are proper, all this chaotic stuff will be described by Liouville density. And the density is a smooth function. Density is proportional to the vorticity of vorticity fields. Whether this limit is justified, whether the rho can be considered as a smooth function, it's not up to my business, but I assume that it's true. And if this assumption can be justified, then we are in hydrodynamics regime. Okay. That's density. Now, the next object which I need would be velocity or flux, which saying how many vortices is passing through a line. And it's a current of vortices, and that's defined as, also very naively, but as a position of vortices multiplied to the velocity of individual vortex. That's assumed to be a smooth function, flux, and then I decompose it as a product of density, which I defined, and velocity, and that's the definition of velocity field. Right? It's a field which smoothly approximates Vi. Another way to say it in more hydrodynamic language is to say that Zi's are Lagrangian coordinates of hydrodynamics, and we are passing through the Eulerian description. That's Lagrangian description, this is Eulerian description. So the mathematical problem which I would like to address is how to pass from Lagrangian description to Eulerian description from the system. Right? naively one can think that we come back to Euler equation, but it's not true. Right? Because this velocity represents slow moving field. Even water moves, water out of the business, out of the picture here. It's only singularity, it's a collection of singularities. So Euler equation which we expect for density and velocity will be different from Euler equations of the fluid. So that's a problem. So I would like to find this object, write the evolution, and compare it with the evolution of the with Euler equation, and they're different. And the difference will be the anomalous term. I sort of assume local equilibrium, right? I can't mathematically justify it, but I show you some collection of formulas which brings the result, but local equilibrium is a major assumption. Whether it's justifiable or not, it's... Okay. So the good way to... let me emphasize, before I show you some calculations, let me emphasize that I'm considering chiral flow. That means, give me a position, I find velocity. So it's not equation of the second order, like Newton equation. Give me a position and velocity, I find the motion. Give me a position. So it's kind of symplectic motion. I have a point, and then the rest of the trajectory is given. Right? So in a sense, density in continuum words language, density determines velocity and vice versa. Right? So looking on this equation, one can write the Hamiltonian field, vector field. So there is a Hamiltonian vector field. It's a motion in symplectic space, in a sense, and it's velocity. So if I have velocity, I will find Hamiltonian. If I have Hamiltonian, I will find velocity and density. They all related. Okay. Now, objects in hydrodynamics which I would like to consider. First is flux. And then there is another major object which very useful for this problem. It's called stress tensor. Stress tensor is a response of energy to general deformation of coordinates and dilatation when rho scaled. So this defines components of the stress energy tensor, which I write in complex notations. The trace will be simply dilatation, response of energy to dilatation, and the holomorphic component is a response of general transformation. It's general this formula. Those components obey the conservation law, elementary conservation law. And once I find one of these components, I will find another component, and also the flux, and then also the velocity. So this is my major object. One is computed. I compute the rest. Okay, in standard hydrodynamics, in water, we open a book and read what it is. It's a square of velocity, and here I mean complex velocity. So the book tells you that for Euler equation, velocity is simply square of, the stress tensor, holomorphic components of the stress tensor is simply square of the complex velocity. This is called kinetic, related to kinetic energy. And it's very convenient to write it in terms of stream function, because fluid is incompressible. Curl, therefore, divergence of u vanish. So there is a stream function called psi, and that's a psi square. However, the stress tensor in vortex fluid, and this is what I'm going to show in a few minutes, possess additional term, and this is anomalous term. Right? So those who are familiar with conformal field theory immediately recognize gravitational anomaly here. And I'm going to explain where does it come from. And once this term is present, all these anomalous forces comes up, and This was my first slide, and hydrodynamics can be deducted. Okay, so I offer in this slide I offer absolutely elementary calculations, which but nicely demonstrate the effect. If you have some energy left, you can simply follow these calculations. Calculation, it's simple, but actually tells the essential. So that's the definition of the stress energy, and this object I would like to compute, but V is given by the Kirchhoff equation, some collection of Magnus force, and this gamma is gamma J is it's all gamma, so same gamma. Okay, I would like to compute it. It's a meromorphic function, obviously, having poles of the first order. I would like to express it through the velocity of the fluid. That's a fluid velocity. I would like to express T through U. Well, how shall I do this? Well, I plug this object here and then use the identity. Identity represents the sum of meromorphic function with a simple pole as a superposition of function, meromorphic function with a double pole and another function with a double pole, all this double pole cancelled. The first term here represents double poles. And this term also represents double poles and altogether single poles. It says that this term designed to cancel higher singularity. And in fluid, in a regular fluid, motion is very fast. So the result would be just that, which represents very singular motion. But in slow, if I concentrate on slow motion, I must subtract this huge singularity. And that's exactly this subtraction. So this term basically represents excluded volume that I is not equal J here in this form, that vortex doesn't talk to itself. It's produced parenthesis. Not really. Where? Here. No, it's okay. I see. So which one do you suspect?
Yeah, then exactly that equation. I don't see why the left side is equal to the right hand side.
Left hand side? Right hand side. I say identity.
Too many indices on the left.
On the left?
Yeah. Z minus Zi and Z minus Zj, I guess. Not too many i's on the left hand side.
No, it's correct for me. It's correct.
But then the right side is wrong. Pick your choice.
Your anyway. It's identity. We can compare poles, but it's identity. It's a part of the so-called Cauchy identity, but it's some elementary part of the Cauchy identity. But I see. I examine the formula again, and I see that it's entirely correct. So here's the sum over I and J. It's coming from substitution of this stuff to here. I is not equal to J, right? Would it be then it consists of the term with the second pole when I supposed to be sort of equal to J and then subtraction. So I and I, it's entirely correct formula. So we can see that double pole here, double pole here, it's derivative, canceled. And only single pole remains. So. But my major point is that this formula is written through fluid velocity, which represents very fast motion. But this is a slow motion, so the things must be subtracted, right?
The confusion is probably coming from the second line.
Second line.
Without any index.
Sorry?
But the sum, the second line.
Here, this line?
Yeah.
This over J. This formula is correct. This is over J, right? You meant that formula?
You know, it's early in the morning, so we are a little generous with your formula.
Thank you. So this is J, right? Sum over J.
Yeah.
That's wrong. But that's the formula.
Another question, but you said you take gamma all equal, or gamma J is
equal? All equal.
All equal.
Mm-hmm. All equal. Okay. So Okay, I have 5 minutes left, so let me proceed. So once you do this computation, you will find eventual velocity of the slow fluid. And that's related to the velocity of the fluid itself plus this additional anomalous term. So if you velocity of the slow motion is given, to find the velocity of the fast motion needs a solution of Liouville equation. That's a Liouville equation. And in this box, it's written for the stream function. And see the stream function of the vortex flow, of the slow moving flow, and the stream function of the fast flow of the fluid deflect from each other by this interesting anomalous term. So that means that if you draw lines, flow lines of water, and flow lines of vortices, they're not completely frozen, they're not completely the same, but they're separated by this interesting term, so they cross each other. Right? So those who are familiar with SLE knows a picture of Scott-Sheffield pictures about difference between flow lines and level lines in Gaussian field, and it's exactly the same formula. They deflect. Okay. Once it's done, one can compute the Hamiltonian. It's also offer the anomalous term. Passing from velocity field of the fluid to the velocity field of the vortex fluid, we get hydrodynamics, but with the interesting additional terms. And you can see that the motion is chiral, so the velocity and the density of vortices are related through this Liouville equation. So it's one motion. It may be of some interest to see how Poisson algebra changed. That's a standard Poisson algebra for hydrodynamics of the incompressible fluid. But the flux, which is the density of vortices multiplied to their velocity, deviate from the canonical hydrodynamics by anomalous terms. This algebra may not be recognizable, but in some limit, it becomes a Virasoro algebra. And that would be a central extension of the Virasoro algebra. The Virasoro algebra comes in a limit, which is not taken here, but that's a full algebra, which obeys Jacobi equations and so on. I've never seen this algebra in literature, but that's another Poisson-Li algebra, which kind of described by that fluid, and that extension is representation of exclusion of fast motion. Okay. So I need, I'm supposed to finish in 2 minutes. I would like to make some few last comments. So as I said, that slow motion of vortex fluid described by anomalous term, anomalous forces which acting normal to the shear, pushing shear to the boundary. So if I have fluid here and vortices, and I organize a shear flow, then apparently this vortex is pushed into the towards the boundary. It's maybe of some interest to see how all these forces acting in the curved space. Well, one can deduct it very simple because, in a simple manner, because stress energy tensor has been calculated, and only what is necessary is to change the volume. Then the Hamiltonian acquire additional term, which is known in quantum gravity, and which is called Liouville action. R represents curvature. Gamma is the circulation of elementary vortex. And that's Laplace-Beltrami operator. Stress tensor itself acquire a trace, which is proportional to the curvature. And for example, if you consider, and then there is a consequence that if flow is stationary, and for example, we have a flow on a cone, then vortices like to go here, to the tip, to the air patches of positive curvature. And they concentrate right on the tip according to this number, which will be an Euler characteristic of the cone. These two formulas are known as a gravitational anomaly, and this is called gravitational trace anomaly, and this is mixed anomaly. So I'm about to finish. Just a second. Just one more. Have one more slide. Okay. A progressive way to think about fluid is in terms of gravity. So fluid moving around the table. So you can think about density as a metric in the space. So kind of distance between these vortices is represented a metric. Motion of this fluid here, you may think about motion of the surface if treat density as a surface. That's offer a view on random matrix models where all this comes from a point of view of Riemann geometry. So I would like to offer, so all what I have said comes from that matrix model, and I would like to explain notations and stuff. Suppose I have a Riemannian manifold, and actually Keller manifold. Suppose I have a Keller manifold, which is in two dimensions the same thing. And let K would be a Keller potential, such as its Laplacian is element of volume. So let me consider a random matrix model, but in two dimensions, I mean Dyson gas, with a parameter beta. This is van der Mond. But potential is a Keller potential, and the integration over volume is covariant. Okay. So I would like to make a correspondence Keller manifold to that formula. That formula. And think about correspondence between manifold and random matrix on the manifold. Everything arranged here nicely, such as all the formula which we obtained, all the distribution of these ZIs which we obtained from this formula will be gravitationally generally covariant. In particular, many objects of all objects of Keller geometry will come as expectation values of objects in this random matrix ensemble. But random matrix ensemble offer the possibility to study fluctuations, and therefore offer a random metric on Keller manifolds. And this is the last sentence. So you can think about this vortex flow as the following. Suppose I have a surface, and every vortex, and the fluid on the surface, and every vortex represent a small cone singularity, and there are many cone singularities, and they are moving. So this vortex, this sheet with many cone singularities, can essentially represent the arbitrary manifold, arbitrary surface. And they're moving, and the surface fluctuates. There is a recent mathematical development which shows that that simple thing offers the only possible covariant metric, random metric measure on Keller manifold. The result belongs to Zeldich and Klevtsov, and in a sense to Zabrodin and myself, but it's kind of business. I repeat, that there is a mathematical result recent which belongs to Zeldich, Klevtsov, and Ferrari, I guess, which says that this random matrix integral, where entries are related to the Keller manifold, offer a proper and the only covariant measure on random matrix on Keller manifolds. And all my story of hydrodynamics is kind of another reflection of that story. And I stop.